I'd like to talk about shot noise in electronics. Shot noise originates from the discrete nature of electrons. Let me give you an example. Let's consider a conductor that has a DC current flow through it. This would happen, for example, if you had a battery with a particular voltage on it and the conductor had a particular resistance R. Since V equals IR, if you had a low voltage, you would have a low current. If you had a high voltage, you would have a high current. In either case, the current is DC. Let's now review what DC current actually means. And for this, I'm going to consider a certain cross-section of the conductor. Let's say hypothetically that our DC current is 1 ampere. It means that 1 coulomb per second flows through that particular cross-section. I'm going to add a negative sign in front of our current here, just so that our electrons move in the same direction as the arrow I've drawn. How many electrons per second pass through that cross-sectional area? Well, 1 coulomb equals 6.24 times 10 to the 18th power electrons. Therefore, if we have 1 ampere of current flowing, we're going to have 6.24 times 10 to the power 18 electrons per second passing through any cross-section in our wire. That's a huge number of electrons. And this brings us to the first thing we can say about shot noise. It doesn't affect us if the current is large. What if the current flow is very small, though? When the current flow gets to be very small, or you sample it over very small time intervals, then the shot noise can start to matter. Let me show you what I mean. I'm going to graph the current flowing through our cross-sectional area as a function of time. If it's a DC current flow without any noise, this graph would just be a straight line. The height of this line above zero just represents our DC current flow. How would this change in the case of noise? In the case of a noisy signal, we expect fluctuations. In other words, we expect an AC signal superimposed upon our DC signal. That was true in the case of Johnson or thermal noise, and it's also true here in the case of shot noise, with an important exception. To illustrate the exception, I want to return to the physical cause of the shot noise, that is, the discrete nature of electrons and current flow. Since charge comes in discrete steps and is not a continuous function, we expect our current to actually be a step function if you look at it on a fine enough scale. We still have an average DC current flow, but the AC fluctuations are discrete rather than continuous. This is the nature of shot noise. Superimposed upon this DC current flow is an AC signal. The probability distribution of that AC signal is approximately Gaussian when the signal is large. In other words, it's less likely to find the signal dropping down to this point than it is to find the signal dropping down to this point. Likewise, it's also not very likely to find the signal ever reaching some point up here at this level. It's more likely to find it down here at one of these lower levels. What happens when the current flow is really small, though? That is to say, assume that we just have a few electrons passing through that cross-section every so often. Sometimes we might have one electron passing through our cross-section. Sometimes we might have two. Sometimes we might have three. The point that I'm trying to make here is that you can never have a negative electron passing through your cross-sectional area. Now, in the case of thermal noise, we could, because with thermal noise, electrons are colliding into one another and running off in random directions. So sometimes through any given cross-sectional area of a conductor, you might have a flow of electrons in either direction. But that's not going to be the case with shot noise. We're not considering any thermal fluctuations here. All of the electrons are moving in the same direction, which means that we're never going to get a negative current flow here. For that reason, the probability distribution function for shot noise is not going to be Gaussian. It's approximately Gaussian when the electron flow or when the current flow is large, but when you get close to zero current flow, or equivalently, you just have a few electrons passing through your cross-sectional area, it's not going to be Gaussian anymore. A Gaussian distribution function would not be correct, because if it were Gaussian, we would expect some fluctuations down here below zero. Shot noise follows a Poisson distribution. The random variable here is the electron count, or the number of electrons measured passing through our cross-sectional area within a given time of measurement. For large numbers, the two distributions, Gaussian and Poisson, are nearly the same. Regardless of whether the current is high or low, we have the same physical phenomenon here, a discrete flow of charges. In other words, we have a DC flow of current with an AC signal superimposed upon it. When we're talking about noise, it's the AC signal that we're interested in characterizing. What I'm going to do now is to just write down the equation that describes that RMS current, and then we'll see what all it depends on. It depends on the charge of a single electron Q, the average current, or IDC, and the bandwidth, which I'm calling here delta F. There's no resistance in this equation like there was with thermal noise. Shot noise is quantum mechanical in nature. If I wanted to know what voltage in a circuit would be caused by the shot noise, I could just use Ohm's law, V equals IR, where I here is the RMS current. I could then calculate an RMS voltage. Notice the bandwidth in this equation. If you're operating at a very high frequency, a very large bandwidth, or equivalently, if your measurements depend on a very short time scale, then the shot noise starts to matter. It also matters when the DC current tends to be very small, the fluctuations relative to that current then tend to be larger, and it also tends to matter when the temperature is very, very low. In that situation, the thermal noise doesn't make so much of a difference, and then the shot noise becomes more important. Let's now use this equation to work an example, and then I'll give a little bit more insight into how this equation comes about. Let's assume that we have 100 milliamps of DC current passing through a conductor, and I'm interested to know what RMS shot noise current will result over a 1 hertz bandwidth. The charge of a single electron is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19th coulombs. Our DC current is 0.1 amperes, and our bandwidth is 1 hertz. Amperes is coulombs per second, so let's change this unit to coulombs per second. Likewise, hertz is just inverse seconds. The units under the square root sign are coulombs squared per second squared. So when you take the square root, you just get coulombs per second, or amperes. Plugging in all of these numbers, we come up with 179 picoamps. Our DC current was in the milliamp range, and the AC current due to the shot noise is in the picoamp range. So there's literally a billion times difference between these two currents. The shot noise here will probably not matter too much. Let's go back to our little model of shot noise and define an interval delta T over which we're going to make a measurement of current. A charge Q will flow through our cross-sectional area over this interval. We can thus say that I equals Q divided by delta T. Because of the discrete nature of charge, Q is the number of electrons times the elementary electrical charge Q. The count of electrons here is a random variable. The reason why the number of electrons, or shot noise in general, is random is because it's a random process that initiates this electron flow in the first place. If you have a battery producing the flow of currents, then the chemical process that causes the electrons to flow around in the circuit tends to follow a random process. Likewise for photocurrent, and likewise for many other physical processes that result in flow of current. We're going to be interested in knowing what the RMS current is due to the noise, or what the expected value of that current is going to be. We're interested here in knowing what the expected value of the current is. Because the elementary charge Q is constant, and if we keep our measurement interval delta T constant as well, then the expected value of the current should be proportional to the expected value of N. Now I'm going to use the fact that shot noise follows Poisson statistics. According to Poisson statistics, the variance equals the mean. There's the variance, and there's the mean. We're going to use this fact in just a moment. I can simplify the left side here just a little bit. I'm going to isolate this term on the left side of the equation. Recall that our goal is to find the root mean squared of the current. Let's find the mean square of the current first. We can take the root later. I know what I is because I've defined it over here. I can now pull out the constants, Q and delta T. I can now substitute for the mean of N squared from over here. I now want to take this equation and move the average N to the left side. We can substitute that in for our N. We can substitute it for our second term as well. The second term is just the square of our DC current, or average current. It's this first term that we're interested in. This is the term of the fluctuations. Although this derivation is not completely rigorous, it gives you some idea of the origin of these terms in the equation. We can see that because we have a delta T in the denominator here, we have a delta F in the numerator. That is, the smaller the time interval, or the higher the frequency, the larger the RMS current. We also have the charge Q in the equation, and we have the DC current I where they need to be. We have this factor of 2 that comes up now and then. This bandwidth here is the single-sided bandwidth. Although not completely rigorous, I hope that you've learned from this video what shot noise is, how you can calculate the RMS current or voltage due to the shot noise, and which situations you might find shot noise to be a problem in.